In order to get close to Christ, each of us must individually submit to Him every day. Not to me, not even to the church, to Him.
Taking a step of faith. Walking out on the promises God made. Taking a giant leap in the air. Stepping out on nothing and finding something there. Telling the doubt to wait. I'm taking a step of faith.
We all want that, But in order to have the faith to draw close to Jesus, we may have to do some things differently. The way we've done things up until now may not work. Now, some of you sitting here under the sound of my voice might be walking close to Christ. You're at a stage in your life where your relationship with Him is close. You can sense it. You feel like He's your friend. But then others, this is the first time you've thought about Him today. And so we begin to think, okay, am I really walking close to Jesus? Or do I need to at least consider doing a few things differently in my life? For the concluding sermon of this message, we turn to James chapter 4. I hope you'll open your scriptures with me. If you didn't bring one with you, there is one right there in front of you in the hymnal rack. So if you'll take it out and open it to James chapter 4, it's near the end of the New Testament. And we're going to read the first 10 verses together. James chapter 4, beginning with verse 10. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You desire, but do not have, so you kill. You covet, but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that He jealously longs for the Spirit He has caused to dwell in us? But He gives us more grace, and that is why the Scripture says, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning, and your joy to gloom. Humble yourself before the Lord, and He will lift you up. Now, this is not a message about legalism. This is not a fire and brimstone message. Although I know as we read that text, it's starting to sound a little bit like that. But we're looking at this in terms of how do I get close to Christ? How do I do more than just go through the motions? Just show up for church on a Sunday morning and punch my card and I've done my religious duty for the week. We want to go farther than that. And so first of all, we see there in verses 1 through 3 that getting close to Christ requires selflessness. Now if you're a note taker, there are going to be three S's you want to watch for. So getting close to Christ requires selflessness. Now James says that the fights and quarrels that battle within us are caused by certain things. Selfishness is at the root of those things. I want what I do not have, and I get angry when I don't have it. Now come on, we don't ever really grow out of that, do we? We want what we want, and sometimes we find ourselves angry because we don't have it. I want what my neighbor has, and we know from Jesus' teachings that a neighbor can be anyone, not just the person next door. I want what my neighbor has, whether it be material, or accolades, or a little bit of fame, or they're just better looking than me. And I want what they have. And sometimes we end up fighting about it. I ask God for what I want, but He does not bow to my selfishness, so my prayers go unanswered. Basically, I'm a mess. Now I've used the personal pronoun there to make everybody more comfortable, but lest any of you begin to laugh and say, yeah, preacher, you are a mess. You are too. We all are. And now please don't be offended by that. You are a beautiful creation of God made in His image. But we sinned, didn't we? And I am accountable personally for my sin. And I am also born into the sin nature that plagues humanity. We're a mess. And our only hope is to strive for and eventually reach the state Paul came to when he wrote in Galatians 2, I have been crucified with Christ. and I no longer live. Now, we're not talking about ending your life or going through awful execution or anything like that. What we are talking about is dealing with our self. That's the thing. How many of you parents have ever come home from a day and heard your spouse say to you, go in there and deal with yourself? Because there's a child in the other room that's been acting like you all day. You ever get that? You ever look at your kids and wish they hadn't inherited all the negative characteristics? And you get this, go in there and deal with yourself. Well, there's a little bit of theology in that humor. Our individual selfishness is at the root of all, of most, if not all, of our sin. Take a glance at the Ten Commandments sometime. You'll find them in Exodus 20 in the Old Testament. You'll also find them in Deuteronomy 20. Go look at them and see. The very first commandment is, have no other gods before me. We don't have any trouble with any other god being before him except, guess who? Me. I want me before God. I want me before my neighbors. That's why I covet what they have. I get angry sometimes, and I want what I want, and I want it now. So maybe we're tempted to just finagle it or steal it, as the scripture puts it. And the whole list of those Ten Commandments, as we go down through them, can be rooted in ourself, in trying to deal with ourself. And until you and I each effectively crucify ourselves, the way Paul puts it, we will not get close to Christ because our growth is stunted and there just isn't enough room for him. We have to deal with ourselves. I have to deal with myself. And you have to deal with yourself. And this sounds like an impossible task, a mountain we could never climb. But do not be discouraged because, secondly, getting close to Christ requires steadfastness. Sitting here right now, on the first Sunday of April, you may determine, yeah, I want to deal with myself. My life is not where I want it to be. It's certainly not where God wants it to be. I've got some work to do. I want to deal with myself. That's a wonderful resolution. That's a great thought. But it will not happen today. It takes time. And many times we get discouraged and we stop because it doesn't happen fast enough. Many of us have been pursuing Christ all of our lives. I came to know Jesus as my Savior when I was 10 years old. And this summer, I'll be 55. You do anything for 45 years, wouldn't you think you'd be really good at it? It doesn't quite work that way, though. Spiritual maturity requires steadfastness. James talks about that in verses 4 through 6 when he calls his readers and us an adulterous people. Now, oftentimes when we think of adultery, our minds go to sexual sin because it's most often associated with that in Scripture. But at the root of adulterous is wavering in one's commitment. Isn't that what adultery becomes? We waver in our commitment to the one that we made a commitment to, whether it is a spouse or God himself. And he calls us an adulterous people because we waver in our commitment to him. Temptation comes along and off we go. Or we have a decision to make and it's a choice between doing things the way Scripture has taught us to do them or doing them the way culture teaches to do them, and we choose the culture. You see? We waver. We go back and forth. Remember Joshua said in Joshua 24, choose for yourself this day whom you will serve. And Jesus put it this way in Revelation 3. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. And because you are lukewarm, neither cold nor hot, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. That lack of commitment, that lack of steadfastness is so important for us to consider that when Jesus puts it this way in the book of Revelation, the translators were polite. In your King James translation, I believe it says spew. In this translation of the NIV, it says, spit. Well, that's not too offensive to our palate. That doesn't bother us a little bit before dinner. But the actual Greek word there would translate better into English, vomit. How's that before lunch? But the idea is this lack of steadfastness makes Jesus sick. See? So, I am an agent of free will. Right? You are as well. You can choose to do anything you want. And in this country, we have freedoms that they don't have in other countries. We can say and do a lot of things. But Jesus says you have to choose. You can choose whatever you want. But I want you to choose one or the other. Steadfastness requires a choice and the conviction to maintain one's choice. That's where the rub is. Sitting here today, we can choose and say, and we can resolve, yeah, today I'm going to deal with myself, I'm going to do better, I'm going to be steadfast in my commitment, and then we get out the door. It's choosing yourself, or making a choice, and living with your choice. It's the Mr. Miyagi principle. Remember? In The Karate Kid, when he leans there on the door of that beautiful classic automobile, and he says to Daniel, the young man, you have to choose. Man drives on one side of the road, pretty okay. Man walks on the other side of the road, drives on the other side of the road, pretty okay. Man who goes right down the middle, psh, like a grape. We have to choose, my friends. The Christian life is a wonderful way to live, but do not make the mistake of thinking it is easy. There are choices and decisions that you and I must make every day. That's why Paul wrote in Romans 12, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Living sacrifice. That's an interesting term. The problem with living sacrifices is they tend to move around. Think about it. If it's a living sacrifice, you can get up off the altar and sacrifice it on it. You can go on and do it and do some more. And so, in order to get close to Christ, each of us must stick to the task. Stay after it. Be determined to make progress a little bit every day, moving ever closer to Jesus, and be steadfast in our commitment to Him. Now, this is going to bring us to a place of decision, because here's the third S. Getting close to Christ requires submission. I have to choose to do things His way, not my own, because sometimes we're going to disagree. And I must submit myself to Him. Verses 7 and 8 cover that. Submit yourselves then to God. Come near to God, and He will come near to you. And then James goes on with this list. And oh, by the way, a bonus initials. You know, I use initials a lot in my sermon outlines. Four C's. And it begins with verse 8. Wash your hands, you sinners. Be clean. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be committed. Grieve and mourn and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Be contrite. And humble yourselves before the Lord, and He will lift you up. Be content. I must seek to walk clean before my Lord. I must strive for it. I know, we're all human. Nobody's perfect. But we don't stop the pursuit. I must determine to follow the teachings of Christ above all others, recognizing that Scripture is the source of truth in my life. I must repent when I sin. That's contrition. It should bug us when we sin against God, shouldn't it? As we sit here as believers in Christ who are walking in Him and attempting to follow Him, shouldn't it make us sad when we sin? Shouldn't it make us even angry? Shouldn't I go before the Lord sometimes even in tears, repenting of the sin that I have committed? Yeah, we should. And I must trust Him for who I am and for whatever is in my life. That's the contentment that he talks about in verse 10. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and He will lift you up. In other words, say to God, look, you do with me what you want, because I trust you, and you know better. In order to get close to Christ, each of us must individually submit to Him every day. Not to me, not even to the church. To Him, every day, I come before Him in submission. Lord, I want to do things Your way. Now, if I'm going to have the faith to get close to Christ, I'm going to have to deal with myself and learn to be selfless, to let His ways come first, to let service of others come first. And I must be steadfast in my commitment to Him and in our relationship. You know, you have to pursue relationships in order for them to be good, don't they? You have to work on them. And I must submit to Him and His teachings every day. It doesn't stop. Like I said, I accepted Christ when I was just a young boy, 1972, 10 years old. And I'm still, every day, facing the same decisions that everybody else faces. My areas may be different than your areas, but we're all tempted. And we all have to work on those things and making Him a priority. So I have to submit to Him every day. The first step in that process is receiving Christ as your Savior. I pray that you have done that. If you have not, this may be the day when you choose to do that. And I'd love to talk with you about that after the service is concluded. But if you have received Him as Savior, how is your walk with Him? Are you close?
Oh,
taking a step of faith. Walking out on the promises God made. Taking a giant leap in the air. Stepping out on nothing and finding something there. Telling the doubt to wait. I'm taking a step of faith.